World War II ignited the explosion of technology that gave us the word aerospace. Jet aircraft, atomic weapons, radar, and rockets were all products of war. Langley engineers were now among the first to explore the high-speed frontier called the sound barrier. In the 19th century, physicist Ernst Mach recognized that a moving object causes waves of air pressure to radiate from it at the speed of sound. An object at the speed of sound will experience an abrupt buildup of pressure, causing a shock wave. Since then, anything traveling at the speed of sound is said to be traveling at Mach 1. The most difficult speeds to study were transonic speeds, those just below through just above the speed of sound. Transonic research began at Langley in the 20s, when John Stack and his colleagues observed the sharp rise in drag as airflow approached Mach 1. The chief culprit was a phenomenon called compressibility effects. As a plane travels faster, a pressure wave builds up on the top of the wing. As the plane approaches Mach 1, drag increases and lift decreases. The stresses could tear the aircraft apart. Indeed, some pilots had died in their assault on the sound barrier. Enter Langley researcher Robert T. Jones. In 1943, Jones was the first American to realize that the angle of an airplane's wings could make a critical difference in supersonic flight. Jones calculated that at faster than sound speeds, the air flowing over a thin, swept back wing would actually be subsonic, delaying or preventing compressibility effects. This swept wing concept would soon be the basis for a new generation of aircraft. But investigating transonic speeds was frustrating. As air moved through wind tunnels near Mach 1, shock waves would form and the wind tunnel would choke, rendering the test data unreliable. This choking problem was eventually solved by John Stack and Ray Wright. By placing slots along the walls of the wind tunnel, they could reduce or eliminate shockwave interference.
Well, it was the breakthrough that we've long been looking for. It led almost directly to the area rule concept, which Dick Whitcomb and others discovered just from the experimental data in the tunnel. And the area rule concept changed how you configured aircraft forevermore. And in 1951, John Stack and his associates received the Collier Trophy.
While Stack and his colleagues were trying to solve the choking problem, others gathered transonic data in other ways. Langley's Flight Research Division measured airflow around wing models during steep dives. And on Wallops Island, Langley's Pilotless Aircraft Research Division launched over 2,000 rockets to gather high-speed data. But wing flow and rocket model tests were stopgap methods of gathering transonic data. The research airplane was the tool to shatter the sound barrier. Proposed by John Stack and developed by Langley researchers during the war, the rocket-powered X-1 was ready for flight by 1947. Heavily instrumented, the X-1 was a flying laboratory using the sky as its wind tunnel. The pilot on this historic flight was a young Air Force major named Chuck Yeager. As Yeager rocketed through shockwaves, Langley ground crews confirmed that he had flown faster than sound. The date was October 24, 1947, and a new era of aviation had begun from Langley research.
The X-1 forever ended the idea that there was a wall, a sound barrier, beyond which further flight was impossible. In terms of technology, because the X-1 was a heavily instrumented aircraft, the NACA and the aircraft industry learned a good deal about transonic and supersonic aerodynamics.
But the sound barrier was broken by brute force with rockets. More practical solutions were needed to make supersonic flight a reality. Throughout the late 40s and early 50s, a new generation of military aircraft sprang from the X-1 research. Conflict in Korea and the anxieties of the Cold War summoned forth new aircraft capable of going higher and faster. But some of these aircraft could not fly as fast as planned. Langley research showed why. As conventional designs approached the speed of sound, two different shock waves built up, one on the fuselage and one on the trailing edge of the wing. Drag was greater than anyone had predicted.
After I got all these results, they were very, very odd looking. And so I was sitting there one day with my feet up on my desk and contemplating all these things, and it all just came together just like a light bulb lighting over your head as you see in the comics. And so that is where how I arrived at the area rule, just adding all the various things together.
Whitcomb envisioned a way to make more room for the air to stream along the fuselage of an airplane. His inspiration was to pinch the waist of the fuselage where the wings were attached. It was a simple, elegant, and brilliant solution that would influence the design of all supersonic aircraft to follow.
What we're talking about with both the slotted throat and the area rule is a result of a very creative process involving visualization, a way of seeing heretofore unimagined shapes and configurations in the mind's eye, pictures in the mind. It's very much the way that an artist or an architect works. We don't think about engineers working in that sort of way, but historians of technology understand that a lot of the very creative inventions, and certainly the design process, involves artistry. The area rule and the slotted throat really were design processes, and it was through pictures in the mind that the end products were achieved.